Good morning and thank you very much for joining us. I am Yori Folarin. Okay, now that all the ministers are in place, we know the ministries, there's been speculation as to how many ministries shall we have, which ministries shall be merging with what. Now we have a pretty clear picture. And so we'll be looking at, you know, these ministries. This week, we're going to be looking at these ministries, the potentials, and quite frankly, what to expect from them. Now, today, I thought we'd just look at the economy. Because what can you do without money? And not too many people are happy with the economy. There are all sorts of issues. Hopefully, it won't get too technical. Because we were talking just before coming on air, and we're talking about GDP growth, and we're saying that in Nigeria, somebody said maybe it's less than 3%. Some then said, well, you know, IMF actually puts its own, you know, mark on the whole thing. They might take it up to 4%. It was at 6-7% at a certain time. But all those technical things are one thing. My guests will be sort of explaining them and why they don't really see those as a single unit that you can use really to arrive at, you know, very much. But everybody, you don't even have to know about it. Everybody wants the economy to improve. So what are the potentials for that? And just how might the minister now be going about it? Well, I got very capable people to discuss this particular aspect with me this morning. Mr. Yemi Makwaderun, he's a friend of the house. In fact, both of them are friends of the house. Yemi Makwaderun is strategy and governance consultant. Thank you very much for coming on as usual, Yemi.
Good morning, thank you for having me.
Indeed. And a dear friend as well, Sam Olisa. Sam is an economist and he's also a financial analyst. This is right up your alley. Even when economy is not the focus or the subject, there's nothing Sam will say that he won't bring it back to the economy. Good morning. Been quite a while we've had you on.
Thank you, Yeri. Yeah. Thank you for having me this morning.
Our pleasure. Now, first of all, the minister now, Mrs. Adeosun, is in there. She's one of those ministries that people are going to be looking to, you know, for action, especially in this change regime. Now, what do you think she can do differently? Because depending on how you see it, you might say that we've had ministers with varying degrees of competence in the past. So what do you think her challenge is and what are her potentials in terms of, quite frankly, moving the economy forward, not alone, because I imagine the budget and planning ministry is also going to be involved.
Yeah, thank you very much. I think Mr. President has a prerogative of allocating portfolios to ministers, and that he has done. And I think, like he said, he has put round pegs inside round holes. Looking at the Honorable Minister of Finance, looking at where she's coming from, a finance person, a banker, I think the appointment is right.
And the commissioner, finance commissioner, in her native Ogun State.
The appointment is right. And I think looking at her antecedents, she has always been in that sector. With her background, her experience, her versatility, I think she should be able to perform.
All of which she showed in her last position as finance commissioner.
She should be able to perform. I think what Mr. President is looking at this time, she is not looking at somebody from Bretton Woods. We had Okonjo-Iweala, World Bank, Bretton Woods. She came the first time, she came the second time. But what do we have? In Nigeria, I've always been saying it, that Nigeria economy, we need a homegrown finance minister who is familiar with the terrain, who knows exactly what is going on at home. I think for the first time.
Okay, so those
in many
are,
years.
Yes, you think we have that
I
now.
I think we have it right.
And you don't think the arguments apply as we often hear in the sports field, where people, some would say, we need a homegrown coach, national coach. And some say, they never reach. We still need the expertise of more globally exposed people. The arguments don't apply. They don't change.
They can, I swear, apply here because, you know, for you to excel, we need a Nigerian with Nigerian blood.
Okay.
Who is homegrown, who is familiar with the terrain.
Okay.
Who is familiar with the Nigerian economy, the structure of the Nigerian economy, the dynamics of the Nigerian economy, in order to put forward good policies.
and be thoroughly familiar with that, which is nebulously referred to as what is that word now? The Nigerian, you know, factor. Mm. You know, that a person just has to know about all of this. Mm. But the minister and the ministry and her colleagues, we still have to grapple with this whole matter of mono economy. This that oil really is it, or and I expect that the Buhari administration will be looking to see what can be done about diversification. What hopes do you have in that direction?
I think this question actually brings to the fore, in my own understanding, the major reason why the president settled for Kemi Adeosun as finance minister. Now, this is somebody who is an expert in public finance, and the mindset of the public finance person is different from the possibly financial management person. Public finance is all about mostly, you know, service. How do you get the funds, you know, to run government on a sustainable level? And when you look at other climes, I mean, in Europe, in the UK, for instance, I'm not aware of any mineral deposit that is the cash cow for the United Kingdom. Yeah. It's all about taxes, fines, and so on and so forth, you know. Now, when you also look at the experience that, you know, she garnered in 4 years as the Commissioner for Finance in Ogun State, you will also want to give her a lot of credit for the relative stability that Ogun State, you know, experienced, particularly against the backdrop of a governor who is also, you know, a financial expert, you know, an accountant. Now, in Ogun State, she came out with one master stroke. Well, the government came out with one master stroke in terms of, you know, fund generation, even before the advent of, you know, the dwindling allocations from the Federation account. And there was a project the government launched, which apparently looked as a socially oriented program, the Home Owner Charter. But I knew from day one that it took a very perceptive and intelligent person who is seeing beyond the ordinary eye could see to look at that project as a potential major revenue earner for the Ogun State government. And one of the challenges that I put across to them when the program was being launched, you know, myself being a resident in Ogun State, was to let them know that, look, for some of us, we know this is a multi-billion naira, you know, annual money spinner in Ogun State. Can you just give us your word that you're going to be able to put back this money into these communities where these monies are coming from? That was something that people are very eager to part with money to get, you know, their properties, you know, certified. Those are the kind of things that we need at this period.
A bit of thinking, a bit more thinking outside the box.
Out of the box. In a way that the people who are even going to part with the money will see ab initio the value that they will get in return. And then the level of resistance is totally removed or reduced, you know, to the barest minimum. Those are the kind of things that we need now. It's not just about coming out with, you know, new taxes and the rest of it. Now, I'm not suggesting at the federal level this is going to happen. But what I'm saying in essence is that the president possibly was looking for someone who has a track record of thinking outside the box, of being able to generate, you know, revenue for public sector use. And when you look at the fact that oil revenue has gone southward for almost 9-10 months now without any hope of a rebound, it is important that we have such a person, you know, driving that.
Well, thank you, Yemi. You know, Sam, when you're looking at something like the economy, there's so many variables. You just don't know tomorrow. To that extent, it must be somebody who is a very, very keen, perhaps observer and analyst that can even come close. But even then, you can't come all the way. Take, for instance, in the U.S., the housing market just, you know, did what it did It just went and collapsed. I don't know that that was expected. Do you think there are, bearing in mind vagaries of the economy, the inflation, people say we're not saving enough, but first of all, you have to have money before you can save, all those kind of things, to what extent do you think one can plan for them without, as it were, doing oneself in? Saving for a rainy day when it's sunny, it's been sunny for the past 19 months, it's likely to be sunny for another three. discipline, fiscal discipline, and all those kind of things. How is planning going to factor into it?
Yuri, that question is very, very relevant at this stage. You see, Nigerian economy has a very big potential. It's not supposed to be a monolithic economy. Don't forget, I said it is not supposed to. We have a very broad spectrum for this economy to behave, to dance, and to motivate.
To have room to maneuver.
We have agriculture, we have oil sector, we have mining. It's so wide spectrum that at any point in time, just taking 1, 2, 3 should be enough to garner this economy back to part of sustainable growth. You see, the question is that word, fiscal discipline, that we measure, very key. If all your cow, let's say there are 20 cow in the economy, oil sector, agri, mining, tax, everybody is generating fund, and there is no fiscal discipline, we cannot grow. So that is the first thing this regime, this president.
What measures. Is fiscal discipline?
Fiscal discipline is for you not to be wasteful in your spending. You prioritize your needs, you also spend accordingly. So that is fiscal discipline. Now, for instance, let me give you an example. If you are making a lot of money and there is no stopping blockage of wastages, then the thing will be going down the drain.
Okay.
But I think this president wants, the body language speaks the fact that there must be fiscal discipline. And again, you have to reorder your budget. In a situation where the recurrent expenditure is 80%, where the capital is only 20%, it's not good for growth. The economy cannot grow. That means you are consuming most of the things you are producing. You are spending it on governance. So, and I think this is the time too. This is another challenge. I heard this Minister of Finance to reorder that priority.
And usually such reorderings have political consequences sometimes.
Definitely.
Because
people will
people won't be as comfortable.
People will resist change. Uh-huh. But when we say change, there must be change.
Okay.
So if you don't reorder, if you don't restructure to such an extent that you will ease out some money for capital development, you are back to square zero.
Now, it's an interesting point, and I think I can see it where the way Sam makes it. We have had some sort of evidence that with leadership, people will follow. If there's going to need to be any belt tightening a la fiscal discipline, I guess then that's the way it has to be, in as long as it is affecting everybody, you know, sort of equally. And as long as people can see that, no, this is a different time we're in, and it's a change kind of a scenario. And so things are not going to be like before. But if you're asking the ordinary guy walking the street to metaphorically tighten his belt, and there is nothing but opulence seen by those who are making giving such advice, usually it leads to perhaps a lack of success, to put it delicately.
No, I think it's very clear from the outset of this administration, even pre-election, that in the event of a Buhari presidency, we're going to have a very high level of, you know, fiscal discipline. We're going to have less opulence, you know,
in government.
We're going to have drastically reduced cost of governance. And every decision that this president has taken from day one confirms that. And I have no doubt in my mind that this is going to be brought to bear on a larger scale. Now, some of the things that are being done now may appear to be tokenism. For instance, what does 50% of the president's salary come to every month, and the vice president's salary, what impact will that have on the economy as a whole? But already we are beginning to see the right signals being sent even to appointees of the federal government. I mean, something as routine, as basic as inauguration of the new ministers, they were restricted to two guests.
Mm-hmm.
So all these, the
symbols, but highly important symbols.
They are critically important. And you see, those are the things we can see. And when we see that, we can, the populace, the people can have the confidence that these are people you can entrust, you know, with the Commonwealth. And of course, they're going to be along the line, you know, other means and ways of assessing these people, of, you know, checking them and balancing their activities. Of course, the government has said that it's going to be very transparent. So we possibly going forward, going to see the government declaring every revenue that comes into government coffers. And apparently that is the reason why you have the Treasury single account now.
Mm-hmm.
So that centrally you can capture, you
even
know.
All sorts of surprises are coming out of that Treasury single account order. Mind-boggling, you know, facts are coming out.
Exactly. There are certain, you know, MDAs that have hundreds of bank accounts, hundreds, some into thousands. One. MD, your ministry, department, or the agency of government. So how do you track all of that? So I think we seem to be on the right track. And when you look at the ambitious, we may come to that later, but when you look at the ambitious nature of what the 2016 budget is going to be like, you begin to wonder if you're complaining so much about drop in oil revenue, and then you are projecting about 6-7 trillion budget, that must tell you that a whole lot is going to be captured from saving on all these opulence and wastages and leakages that Mr. Olisa, you know, alluded to.
Okay, Sam, the TSA is definitely one kind of a change, even though we've been hearing in recent times about where the law establishing it, you know, originated from, that it might not necessarily have been in Buhari's time, that it was earlier. But that's not the point that really, really concerns me. I wanted to ask if what you think, because this is a subject where all sorts of things are interconnected. You talked about agriculture earlier, talking about the economy, talked about agriculture, talked about solid minerals. Agriculture, when we start to talk about that one, then that one will also talk about roads, how you need roads. So all these things are interconnected. It seems to me that there's a whole lot of work to be done, given what the administration said when it first came, that you can't imagine the rot, not just corruption, but perhaps also abandoned duties, abandoned functions, abandoned capabilities that perhaps people didn't pay attention to. It seems there's a whole lot to be done for us to at least let the engine kick, and then, you know, how smoothly it's running, let the vehicle begin to run in the first instance.
Yeah, I think the Nigerian economy has gone comatose before this government came in. Comatose that you cannot even plan, you cannot project because of the leakages. Then the issue of the TSA came in. It does not really matter who made the law, mm-hmm. but we are talking of practicing it. Mm. So it's just like what we hear in the church. It's not the preacher, the seer. The preachers have said the word that is important, but the doer. So, and I think we give credit to this regime for implementing the TSA. Because first of all, that will block leakages. You will see how people scramble, how MDA scramble. There was a deadline given, and we had to meet. So indirectly, TSA is number one policy that tried to block leakages so that all revenue will come to a single account. All leakages will be blocked. And I think government should continue in that direction to implement it. Then coming to the issue of the potentiality.
Yes, new ideas. Do you think there's anything new that we haven't heard of before?
No, let me tell
you. It's just a matter of how it wasn't well implemented.
Let me tell you, what we need in the next 1 or 2 years is not even new ideas. It's implementing what is on ground. Mm. And that is why I really commend the president for the choice of his men. Imagine the Ministry of Works, Power and Housing
mm-hmm.
given to somebody that has been tested That is Babatunde Fashola. He has run a state. We knew what he did. We knew his antecedents. We knew where he's coming from. As a matter of fact, people were happy when they heard that announcement. If power is restored in Nigeria today, and the roads we have are maintained, are motorable, not even creating new roads, power restores.
Fixing those that exist.
Fixing what is on ground in the next 2 years. Not necessarily bringing in new things. The next 2 years, let's fix what is on ground. It will be marvelous.
So we're not.
It will be wonderful.
So one might not ordinarily think of Tunde Fashola's ministry as the economy, but it's indispensable.
It's crucial. Power is very, very key.
It is.
You know, road is very, very key, and housing. Oh. Don't forget the Maslow's stages of physiological needs of human being: food, clothing, and housing. So how do we get the food across? The roads have to be fixed. The people have to be sheltered. Then there will be power to drive the economy. Every economy that wants to grow, there must be, the power problem must be solved. So looking at that, looking at Agric, putting somebody who is experienced, Aduogbe has farmed for 10 years. People may be saying that he's old, but it's not the one that gets on the field. I've been doing the work. He will use his experience to put the right person, to supervise them, to marshal the growth, to put everything in place so that our Agric sector will be active. That we need to bring in Nigeria right now. We have about 11 decomposing companies producing fertilizer at home. Why are we bringing in fertilizer from abroad? We should encourage those decomposing companies that are already in place and put the policies and fund in place where they can assess and expand.
You know, thank you, Sam. Yemi, now the Buhari administration is in place, the APC administration is in place, and when they were in opposition, they were highly critical. They were adding constructive criticism, even though it might not have been seen like that from the other side, that because, yes, there were some words, cluelessness, the word clueless, I don't know, it was in there. But the thing is, they always had ideas as to how better a thing could be done than was being done at the time. Now they're in the driver's seat. Everybody, both the current opposition and loyalists or fans of APC, members of APC, will expect more than a marginal improvement in the way things are done.
Certainly. We're not looking at just a little more of, you know, what is already on ground. There has to be some real shift.
A radical departure.
And let me say, what gives me, you know, this level of optimism, which I think, you know, many Nigerians also share with me, is the fact that it's not just about trying to win an election. It's also about leading by example. It is also about getting the best brains available. Now, the people you have as ministers today may not be the best brains in Nigeria, but these, to me, are some of the best brains that you can identify with. And for me, I found it even to be a sort of compliment to the president when he came out with his ministerial list. And people said, oh, these are people who should have announced from day one. It means that practically everybody, including the critics, agree with the president that these are really the crop of people that you
know. Or at least find it difficult to fault.
Find it difficult to fault, exactly. And so that is one. And then the other is the distribution of the cabinet. Don't forget that the president had been portrayed, and he's been portrayed by some sections, as being sectional. But if you look at the critical ministries of the economy, the critical people that will drive not just the economy, but even the polity, perhaps the most significant person from the far north is the Minister of Education. Finance, budget and planning, transportation, housing, works, power, investments and trade, everything here. part of petroleum, you know. So it also tells you that there is a president who is ready. Let's assume that everybody has his own their own idiosyncrasies and so on. But is somebody, we have a leader who is ready to actually bring about real change. So he decided to put the best people where, you know, they can they can thrive. And, you know, to add to what Sam said about, you know, the economy and the need for us, you know, to diversify, I think even maritime transport and aviation is one big area that Nigeria can begin, you know, to explore. And when you also look at the background of the people that have been put in those offices, they are people that have like zero margin for failure. These are people who want to leave legacies. You know, they are not startups who want to use it as a pedestal to something else.
And a lot of confidence has been placed.
And there's
on
a lot of public confidence. So they are actually sentenced, you know, to perform and deliver.
To performance. Now, Chris Ngige, he's the guy in charge of, he's the minister in charge of
labor and employment.
And employment. Now, this is another key, you know, factor into this whole question we're talking about. Obama is forever, you know, to the chagrin of his adversaries, saying that, look where we brought up employment to, you know, created so many jobs. Chris Ngige's job is not an easy one.
It's not easy. And he will not do it alone. His ministry will interact with other ministries because virtually every ministry have to create employment, not only the Ministry of Employment and Labor. So
let's come back to, so that you can continue at this point. I have to go to a quick commercial break. Ministry of Employment and
Labor.
Labor and
Employment.
Labor and Employment. Stay with us, please. We'll be right back.